All right, so what I have is basically a case of you can't believe your eyes. So, you know, in a lot of the stuff that we look at in mass, we look for patterns, right? And we try it for a few examples. And if we see a pattern, then we think, oh, maybe this continues on, right? But it's not like a proof. It's not a convincing argument. And so what I want to talk about today is an example of when the pattern just completely misleads us. If you take like a random number, is it more likely to have an odd number of prime factors or an even number of prime factors? That's the basic question, say 10. And the way that it breaks down into prime numbers is that it's the product of 2, which is prime, and 5, which is also prime. So it has 2 prime factors, okay? So it has an even number of prime factors. But of course, if I take any prime number, like say 5 or 2 or whatever, then it only has 1 prime factor, and so it has an odd number of prime factors. You're gonna see when I write it down in a minute that I'm gonna ignore totally the numbers that have repeated prime factors. So I'm gonna define a function, and I'm going to use this notation because all the mathematicians will yell at me if I don't.
What is that?
So this is the letter mu. And what this function is going to do is it's going to take in a number and it's going to output 1 if n, my number, has an even number of prime factors. So like 10, we talked about that example, because 2 and 5 are its prime factors, but also none repeated. It's going to give me the value minus 1. If all this stuff is still true, except I have an odd number of prime factors, any prime number would be given the assignment of the value minus 1 under this function. We'll give it the value 0 if a prime is repeated when we factor the number. Let's do some hands-on work here because this is kind of a complicated definition.
Does it get a 0 if the prime, because sometimes you get a factorization where a certain factor is repeated,
yeah,
and another one just appears once, like, you know, 2 times 2 times 2 times 5.
Yeah, yeah.
That would count as a 0?
So that would count as a 0. If any time we have a repeat, then we assign 0 to this thing. Yeah, let's look at some concrete examples, because I think it's easy once you start working with it, but hard to talk about abstractly. Okay, so here's my numbers, and I'll look at the values of this function, mu. So let's forget about 0. I don't want to even think about it. Let's start with 2. Okay, that's a prime number. It has 1 prime factor, which is an odd number. So we assign it a minus 1. 3, same deal. 4, this is the bad news situation where we have a repeated prime factor because it's 2 times 2. So we assign it 0. 5 is prime. It gets a minus 1. 6 factors into 2 times 3. That's 2 number of prime factors. And so we assign it a 1. So let me just fill in a few more here. 8 takes 0. 9 is a square, it takes 0. 10, we already talked about, it has 2 prime factors. And you can keep going, right? All right, so if I want to know which happens more often, all I have to do is add up the values of this function. Because it's negative when I have an odd number of prime factors, it's positive when I have an even number of prime factors. What I should do is just add up the minus ones and the plus ones and just see if I get something positive or negative.
And which side of the ledger are you on?
Which side of the ledger am I on? And this will tell me what's going on. What do I get when I add up these numbers? So in the first initial computation, there's a few more numbers with an odd number of prime factors than an even number of prime factors. So I don't have an answer for you about like what happens more often, because it's a little, you have to be a little careful to formulate what you mean. Because you're sort of doing this trade-off, going back and forth between minus 1 and plus 1, and you can always sort of find another prime number, so there's a minus 1, but then, okay, you can multiply that one by 2. So then there's a plus 1. So you keep going through all of the whole numbers, and you're gonna get lots of minus 1s, and you're gonna get lots of 1s. So there's a lot of cancellation, okay? And so what I mean is that this sum should always be pretty small. Minus 2 is smaller than 7 by a decent amount. You can imagine as you keep going on, the numbers get really big, but the sum doesn't get so big.
Is it going to hover around 0?
So that's the question. So first of all, you can show that it's not going to hover around 0. It's going to zigzag like crazy, actually. But the conjecture, the thing that people thought was true for a long time, was that it's never going to be larger than the square root of the number that you've gone up to. So if I do this and I go up through this process of adding together all these minus ones and plus ones and say I stop at a million, then the thought is, well, okay, whatever number I get, it's some number between minus 1,000 and positive 1,000, because that's the square root of a million.
But it could be either side of 0.
It could be either side of 0. And in fact, it is known that it switches back and forth infinitely often. So that's like a really complicated like thing to
even
think about. Yeah. But
so it could get really high. It could get up into the thousands, and then it could drop to the minus 1,000.
That's right, yeah. And just zigzagging back and forth, sort of living around zero, but in a really complicated way. And so the thought was that, okay, it's complicated, but because I have all this cancellation, it can never be too big. It has to be between minus the square root of the number and the square root of the number. So this is known as Mertens conjecture, because this is called Mertens function, this sum that I'm adding up. And it was thought to be true for a long time, and it turns out that it's not true. But it's crazy, because if you do this, I mean, we can now compute really far out, and you go billions and billions and billions of numbers out, and it still satisfies this square root bound. What is now known is that there is a counterexample to this conjecture. You eventually zigzag out past the square root of the number, but we also know that we have some terrible, terrible bounds on how big the number has to be to actually do this. So it's something like 10 to the 10 to the 40 or something like that.
So do we know the exact number where it first breaks the rule?
Well, I mean, if we knew it, we could never write it down because we would need all of the atoms in the universe to write it down.
Oh, yeah.
So no, the answer is no, we don't know. Like, we have no way to describe the first time that it happens.
But we know it exists.
But we know it exists. So despite all computational evidence that could ever be produced in the history and future life of the universe, we know that it still fails to be true. So what we're looking at is a picture of this function where we're adding up these minus ones and plus ones and going along with the integers. And so as you can see, what's happening is that as we add more and more terms to the sum, we go back and forth. Here's zero. We go back and forth around zero. We start kind of more negative, by the way. That's kind of fun to notice because there's lots of prime numbers that are small. So we go back and forth around zero, but no matter how much back and forth we do, we're not getting anywhere close to this boundary given by the square root of the number. So we zigzag back and forth, positive and negative, but no matter how large we get, we don't even come close to approaching that boundary.
You can't draw that graph for the point where it gets nearer the square root because the numbers are just too big.
Yeah, that's right. The numbers are too big. I mean, it just can't even be written down, much less computed.
But one day, that zigzag, that Alps mountain range, will break free of that square root loop.
It will, but I don't think we're going to be around to see it. Unfortunately.
Does it just break away from that square root rule, or does it blast past it?
So that's a really complicated question. We don't know the answer to that. We know it doesn't go too far past it. But actually, the reason why people were initially, or one interesting thing initially noticed about this question, is that if it had been true, if this false thing had been true, it would imply the Riemann hypothesis, which is this really big open question in mathematics that's thought to be like very difficult and very strong. So understanding the growth, the size of this Mertens function is actually really intimately connected to some of the most difficult problems in mathematics. And I think there was at some point some hope of proving the Riemann hypothesis by proving this conjecture. So when it was shown to be false, we lost that hope.
I love that there's some number floating out there when the rule first gets broken, but we could never even write it down.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, we could never even arrange. I keep going back to atoms in the universe because that's what makes me sort of happy and blows my mind, right? We could never even arrange all of the atoms in the universe to describe it. Like, they could never be lined up in any computable way, but we know it's there.
And it's like finite, it's an exact number.
Yeah, yeah. It's the only way we can describe it is as the first number that fails Mertens conjecture.
Has that got a name? Is it called like his number or something?
No, that's a good point. I don't think it has a name. Maybe we should name it.
That's my new favorite number.
So maybe you go to the gym to get your body in better shape, but what about your brain? How do you get your mind in better shape? Well, how about trying Brilliant? With its enormous library of courses, puzzles, interactive content covering all sorts of mathematical and scientific subjects. And don't worry, there's plenty of prime number stuff if that's your thing. How can you resist this? Now look, everything here has been carefully curated and designed. It's not about what you get right or what you get wrong. It's about guiding you along this beautifully manicured journey to make you a better thinker. Why don't you check them out? Go to brilliant.org/numberphile. That'll get you 20% off their premium subscription, and that unlocks everything, all the good stuff. And trust me, you're going to be busy a long time with all of this. It's brilliant.org/numberphile. Check them out, and our thanks to them for supporting the show.
Mandelbrot set, that's absolutely right. And when I say that I'm going to approximate pi in the Mandelbrot set, I don't mean that I'm going to approximate pi on this picture here.
I mean that I'm going to cook up a bunch of numbers that have to do with the Mandelbrot set that approximate pi.